Hello everyone, my name is Pilar Terres Villalonga and I'm going to talk about logical pluralism. I did my PhD at the University of Barcelona and I'm currently a postdoctoral researcher at the Université Catholique de Louvain in Belgium. Since I started studying philosophy, I have been interested in the debates about logic and philosophy of language and in the connections between these fields. More in particular, I have been interested in the debate about logical pluralism. My PhD thesis explored the pluralist view about substructural logics, interpreting these formal languages as capturing certain pragmatic enrichment, pragmatic phenomena for logical vocabulary. In the current project in Belgium, we are also exploring the possibility of a kind of pluralism, but in a more indirect way, in a project that tries to formalize notions of relevance, grounding, explanation, and truth preservation. So logical pluralism emerged from certain intuitions towards classical and non-classical logics. Non-classical logics emerge from the observation that classical logic somehow fails by considering as valid some inferences which are problematic or seem invalid intuitively, or from natural language, or also some inferences that combined with other acceptable principles lead to some kind of paradox or contradiction. So we have a plurality of logics. We have classical and non-classical logics, and faced with this plurality, the main intuition of logical pluralism, or at least my intuition in the debate, is that there is more than one legitimate codification of logical vocabulary. That is, the different logics understood as formal languages codifying the logical vocabulary, words that follows from and or, can be legitimate. We will see in this presentation just an illustration of these rivalries, and then we will see how logical pluralism can be understood and what are the different versions of logical pluralism and what are the different levels and versions of logical pluralism. So logical pluralism starts or emerges from disagreements in logic. A disagreement is a disagreement about the validity of some inference, such as gamma entails delta. We have that, for instance, these principles here that are acceptable for a classical logic are invalidated by some non-classical logic, by intuitionistic logic, these two, relevant logic, this linear logic, this one here, or order or commutative logic here. Faced with this plurality of logics, logical pluralism is the thesis or the claim that more than one of them is correct or legitimate. That is, we can accept both classical in the two columns that we have seen. We can accept classical and we can accept intuitionistic logic and we can accept relevant logic. However, we need to determine how or in which sense we are accepting them. So stated the pluralist claim, more than one logic is correct or legitimate, we still don't understand, we don't know what it means exactly, because we need to specify what it means to be correct, what it means to be legitimate, what it means to be a logic also. And this is part of what I want to talk about in what follows. A first distinction that will be useful to situate the pluralist debate is the distinction between levels and versions of logical pluralism. On the one hand, we have different levels of pluralism, which correspond to different definitions of what logic is. And then the versions of logical pluralism are the thesis that, given a particular definition of logic, there is more than one. However, we first need to establish what is logic, from a pure system to a pure system applied to correct reasoning or a pure system applied to some domain. Once we have this determined, we can define and defend a version of pluralism. The levels of pluralism are very clearly stated by Graham Priest in his book, Doubt Truth to be a Liar. And he determines that at least there are three levels of pluralism that go from pure logical pluralism to reasoning logical pluralism, and that go from a thesis of pluralism that is trivially true to something a bit more controversial. First, the pure logical pluralism thesis level is that is the claim that different logics are equally legitimate as pure formal systems, formal structures with their own non-interpreted syntax. This is trivially true because it's the case that there is more than one logic in this sense. When the language is not interpreted, we have a plurality of logics. However, when we talk about logic, when we use the word logic, it seems that we are referring to something else, at least in philosophy. We say that some logic is correct or incorrect, not as a pure system, but as something applied to something else, something applied to reasoning, or at least the language is interpreted. So we have the second level, applied logical pluralism. This is the thesis that there is more than one logic legitimately applied to some domain, interpreting the logic or vocabulary accordingly to the domain. Here we can distinguish the external and the internal version. The external says that different logics can be applied to different phenomena. Each domain has its own logic. Or internal, there can be some domain for which more than one logic is legitimate. This doesn't seem very controversial. It's a bit more than a pure logical pluralism, but doesn't seem very controversial because in fact, outside philosophy, people is applying logic to different domains or in philosophy as well. However, this doesn't mean that there is one logic in a sense that we will see later for reasoning. So just to put an example, one can say that classical logic or intuitionistic logic is a logic that is very can be fruitfully applied to mathematics, and then that relevant logic should be applied to something else. However, this doesn't mean that the two of them, classical and relevant, are equally correct for reasoning. So we go to the third level, reasoning logical pluralism. This thesis says that logic is the formalization of genuine logical consequence, and there is more than one. This is a bit more controversial because even if one claims that the domain that applied logical pluralism is correct, one can say for mathematics you can use classical logic. However, the logical vocabulary, independently of any context, should be used in a particular way, in a unique way. So there is just one logic. We have a similar division between local and global pluralists. So local pluralist says that different logical systems are applicable to different areas of discourse. However, they are used for reasoning about them. It's not just an application. It's just reasoning about the area of discourse. Or global pluralist, which is more less controversial or more natural with our idea of what logic is, that says that logical principles should apply irrespectively of subject matter. Now let's turn to versions of logical pluralism. We have language divergence and consequence divergence interpretations of divergences in logic. So we can see the two logics disagree either because the notion of consequence is different between them or because the language is different between them. And depending on how we identify the divergence between two logics, we will have different versions of pluralism. So language pluralism. Language pluralism says that a disagreement between two logics depends on different interpretations of the language, and these two different languages are both legitimate. So as an illustration, if we have that one logic accepts this and another logic rejects this principle, it's because they are using the same notion of logical consequence, but they are using a different sense of no. And both notions of negation are correct. One of the main defenders of logical language pluralism is Carnap. In his principle, so he didn't consider himself a pluralist, but the revisions that have been done, especially by Bill and Restel, have situated him in the map of logical pluralism. Why? Because he had this principle of tolerance, saying it's not our business to set up prohibitions, but to arrive at conventions. This principle of tolerance emerges from two facts. First, he claimed that the meaning of logical vocabulary is determined by the rules of inference that are established in a calculus. And second, there is no right or wrong rules for logical vocabulary, but a tolerance, in fact, towards different formal systems. So it's by convention that we create different systems. It's by convention that we give rules for the logical connectives. And on top of this, there is no correct or incorrect. So if there is no correct or incorrect way of evaluating, we cannot say that this logic is better than this other one, but both are as set of rules correct. Other proposals for language pluralism are modeling, polysemy, and context pluralism. You will find the references at the end. Consequence pluralism is the claim that rivalry between logics is due to different notions of follows from. The language is fixed, the negation is the same. However, there are different notions of follows from, and both are acceptable. We find Bill and Restall's pluralism in this classification. So they built their pluralist thesis from a settled core of consequence that gives a multitude of notions of consequence. This settled core is GTT by general Tarskian thesis, which claims that an argument is valid relative to X, if and only if, in every case, again, relative to X, in which the premises are true, so is the conclusion. Moreover, an instance of GTT is obtained by specification of cases. In GTT, and a specification of true in a case. An instance of GTT is admissible if the resulting consequence is necessary, normative, and formal. A logic is given by an admissible instance of GTT, and there are at least two admissible instances of this consequence principle. So if we, for instance, accept a logic in which the specification of cases are possible walls, this will hold because we won't find a counterexample to this, because there is no world in which both A and not A hold. So there can be no counterexample to this, so this is valid. However, if cases are specified as situations in which there can be contradictions, this is not valid, because we can find a situation in which both A and not A hold, however, B doesn't. So we can construct a case and we can construct a counterexample to this principle. And given that there is a plurality of cases, both are acceptable. So other proposals of consequence pluralism that have nothing to do with Bill and Restall, but they can be classified in this version and not in the language pluralism, are modalism, intratheoretic pluralism, meta-inferential pluralism, and structural pluralism. Again, you will find the references later. And finally, I want to finish this short presentation with a challenge. So it's, if you have pluralist intuitions and you claim that there is more than one logic that is correct, and for whatever reasons you defended this pluralist view, you will find a challenge in explaining the following fact. This is, we find this in discussed in Priest, and also in Stephen Reed, and there is a paper by Stay in which he reviews the different versions of the challenge. So consider, suppose that you are a pluralist and you accept there are two equally good accounts of deductive validity, K1 and K2. Also, B follows, suppose that B follows from A according to one of these logics, K1, but it doesn't follow according to the other, K2. And you know that A is true. It follows by K1 that B is true, but it doesn't follow by K2 that B is true. Should we or should we not conclude that B is true? So this is a challenge, because if you have pluralist intuitions, you should give a definite answer about whether B is true or not, whether B is acceptable or not, independently of any logic. So in case you are interested in the debate, this is something interesting to think about. Finally, here you can find a selection of the main contributions to the debate and some of the papers I have been referred to during the presentations. Okay, that's all. Thanks for your attention.